Aleppo, A History, by Ross Burns, read by Ric Jerrom. Preface. This book was written as the terrible history of Syria's disintegration into war was unfolding. Some of the background as to why the present tragic confrontation in Syria has raged so intensely lies hidden in Aleppo's past. Yet the city's history also teaches us that the sectarian and ideological tensions that might at any point have torn the city apart were never allowed to get out of hand as they have now. The explanation for how a well-tempered society that usually found a way through the worst of crises found itself today caught in the most murderous turmoil that has ever been visited upon it is not the subject of this book. What I hope to convey, though, is some sense of Aleppo as it was, in the hope that it helps inspire a new phase of regeneration in the future. Much of the present conflict in that city has centered on built heritage. Amidst concern for the monuments of Aleppo, however, we should not forget the people. They have been the real tragedy of the conflict, one that has engulfed most of Syria. The postscript gives a provisional tally of the destruction of major monuments, but this should be seen in the context of whole suburbs of civilian housing that have been blasted to rubble, not only denying Aleppines their homes, but also forcing a large percentage of the population to become refugees outside Syria. Damage to monuments should therefore be seen in the context of a massively destructive conflict across much of Syria, of the huge toll it has taken in human lives, over 250,000 at the time of writing, and of the lost opportunities for the country's next generation, who must despair of any hope of a future as they languish in refugee camps or temporary accommodation abroad. Buildings are not just pretty facades. They are part of the fabric of history, and their loss matters. This chronicle of Aleppo's history will frequently pause to look at the buildings that serve as milestones along its path. Today, when self-proclaimed Islamic State, IS, is busy destroying all it can get its hands on, which remind us of a past they would like to see forgotten, it is all the more important to reassemble these milestones in some semblance of order. While documentary, numismatic and archaeological material often give us the precise, raw data on a city's history, it is the building record which can give physical form to the narrative. You only have to consider, for example, the central role that the great citadel of Aleppo serves in today's events, as it looms over the souks, mosques and madrasas of the city's burnt-out central area, to understand how vital it has been in the evolution of the city going back many thousands of years. Ironically, it is the destructive urge of the followers of various Islamist groups which shows how important buildings are as embodiments of memory. In 2014, Islamist forces, followers of another organization, Islamic Front, turned to dust the unassuming mosque that housed the burial chamber of the great Ayyubid leader of Aleppo, Sultan al-Zahir Ghazi, the most successful of Saladin's sons. Islamic Front dug a tunnel under its structure, backed it with explosives, scurried out, and then lit the fuse. Virtually all the building, except for its outer entrance gate, was either turned into a huge dust cloud or sucked into the resulting crater. the Islamists were attacking not just an obstruction cluttering their free fire zone beneath the citadel, but also the physical memory of a successful Aleppan ruler of the late 12th, early 13th century. During Sultan Ghazi's reign, and that of his sons, and through the inspiring tutelage of his widow, Defa Khatun, a series of buildings was erected in Aleppo which testify to the spiritual and political fruit of a period of remarkable stability. Confident in the thought world of their own Sunni beliefs, the leaders of Aleppo in these decades produced two of the most significant buildings of Syria, both models of restraint and harmony in their proportions and sober taste in decoration. Defa Khatun's Paradise Madrasa and the Mashhad Shrine of Hussein. As the Syrian conflict at the time of writing has coalesced around a central theme of a supposed millennial sectarian struggle between Sunni and Shi'i versions of Islam, reading these buildings right becomes even more important. Defa Khatun's Paradise Madrasa is an incomparable statement in stone of the calm and repose which comes through Sunni Islam's search for a paradise, not through the suicide vest, but through spiritual renewal. The Mashhad al-Hussein directed its message to the residual Shi'i community in 13th century Aleppo, conveying respect for the 12 Shi'i imams, and so reminding all Muslims of the need to soften, if not reconcile, their differences. Dedication. I wrote this book because of a promise to an old friend, John Iremonger, a leading figure in Australian publishing who had been through all the fascinating zigzags of a history degree at Sydney University with me. He and his wife, Jane Marceau, fell in love with Aleppo in 2000, perhaps more so than most visitors. He told me I had to put down a record of its wonderful history. 2 years later, John died, not long after holding me to my promise. I feel now I have done something to let him know that all that fascination with history that he helped inspire in me did come to a good end. This book is also dedicated to the Alapines, who have loved their city and sought to convey its unique qualities of hospitality, its traditions, and their pride in the coexistence it espoused. Many have, through their own research, sought to bring their city to a wider audience. This book has gained immensely from the inspiring efforts of Abdullah Khajjar to catalogue the city's monuments for the visitor. Many other Aleppan and foreign researchers laboured over the past century, so many that their best tribute lies in the bibliography, which can be found in the print version of this book, where their devoted research is recorded. There you will see that Henri Sauvager, Jean-Claude David, Anne-Marie Edde, Julia Gonella, Ernst Hertzfeldt, Carol and Robert Hillenbrandt, Bruce Masters, André Raymond, Sobhe Soaf, Yasser Tabar, are some of the names whose contributions span many productive years. All of them have pushed new barriers in reaching our understanding of one of the most complex and fascinating of cities. One of the challenges for the next generation, however, would be to progress our knowledge of the rich Arab sources which have been left without new critical editions and translations since the pioneering work of the 19th century savants. Other friends and scholars have contributed in many other ways, including the panel of readers, who were suborned into giving their opinions or informed comments on the text or parts thereof. This book would never have taken root without the people of Aleppo, whose hospitality and pride in their city lured me back to the place innumerable times over 3 decades. This book, in a small way, seeks to remind us what can be saved. It can, however, never fully capture the generosity of the people of that great city before they were crushed under the weight of events on a destructive scale possibly exceeding the last Mongol invasion 600 years ago. No city has ever deserved the fate Aleppo is experiencing now, least of all Aleppo. Chapter 1. Setting the Scene. Bronze and Iron Ages. Early Bronze Age, circa 3600 to circa 2000 BC. Middle Bronze Age, circa 2000 to 1600 BC. Late Bronze Age, circa 1600 to circa 1200 BC. Iron Age, circa 1200 to circa 539 BC. Persians, 539 to 333 BC. Aleppo must have one of the most mundane settings for a major city. Many travellers in the past have noted that it fails to announce itself. This was put in a characteristically blunt style by an Australian officer, Hector Dinning, at the end of 1918. He had been one of the celebrated light horsemen whose mounted charge at Beersheba the previous year had helped bring the collapse of the Ottoman Arab Empire. Sent north at the end of the war to join the British occupying forces in Syria, he noted, "If you look at Aleppo from a great height, you will see little of natural beauty. You will see nothing but a flat sea of housetops with the bare island of the Citadel rearing somewhat uncouthly from the midst. That is all, excepting the scanty orchards that lie on the fringe of the desert." It is undeniable that Aleppo lacks a defining context, stranded on a corner of the dusty North Syrian plain and too far from the highlands of eastern Anatolia to the north, to benefit in terms of distinctive geographical features. It is only as you descend the bowl of low hills forming a perimeter that the striking profile of the great medieval citadel rears, competing today with graceless skyscrapers in your line of sight, but still commanding attention. Aleppo's only water resource was the Quake River, a small 130-kilometer-long stream that flowed out of the hills around Aintab, modern Gaziantep, to the north in Turkey. The river fed a thin band of grain cultivation, orchards and kitchen gardens, supplying just enough to attract settlement in an area otherwise deprived of water needed to supplement the low seasonal rainfall. Though the floodplain of agricultural land reached by the river widened as it flowed past Aleppo, the Quake could not in itself support a major population centre. What little the stream can muster today is siphoned off well before it reaches Aleppo, surviving only as a stormwater drain through a modern city park. 30 or so kilometres south of Aleppo, the river gave up the struggle against the harsh reality of the Syrian steppe and evaporated in marshes to the south. Most major historic urban centres that survive through to modern times have an obvious asset that would have recommended them to their founders. The vigorous Barada River supplies Damascus with its snow-fed flow even during the summer months, and sustains an extensive oasis in what would otherwise be desert. In the case of Antioch, 100 kilometres to the west, near the Turkish coast, the city, founded by one of Alexander the Great's successors, was fed by the waters of the Orontes. That river brought the inland runoff from the Lebanon and Syrian coastal mountains and bounced along with such enthusiasm that it earned itself in the past the Arabic nickname the Rebel. Stripped of the accumulated overburden of more than 5,000 years, it is hard to identify what Aleppo offered its first settlers. This corner of the steppe lies at around 400 metres above sea level. To the southeast, the land stretches for hundreds of kilometres towards the deserts of Arabia. To the north, the ground rises slowly until it meets the southern limit of the eastern Anatolian highlands and the Antitaurus Mountains. As the terrain reaches around 450 metres in elevation, it forms an ideal corridor, bordering the foothills, providing easy access from west to east, the historical route along which much of the contact between the civilizations of the Mediterranean and the great cultures of Mesopotamia and Iran flowed. It first passed into written records as the Royal Road that bound the Persian Empire, linking its royal center, Susa, in modern-day Iran, as far west as the Aegean Sea. Aleppo, however, lies some way south of that corridor. The easiest and shortest connection from the Mediterranean to the basin of the Euphrates and Tigris rivers is the inland road from Orontes' mouth at Samandag. Aleppo is less than 100 kilometres from the coast. After traversing Antioch, modern Antakya, the route heads inland through a convenient gap in the range of mountains that sweeps south from the Antitaurus range, petering out in the Sinai. Another 50 kilometres brings it to Aleppo, and from there the shortest connection to the Euphrates lies across featureless, dry agricultural land. The Aleppo route provides virtually an open door to the great agricultural spread of the land of two rivers, or Mesopotamia. If there is any advantage in Aleppo's situation, it lies in its proximity to the point where the route inland from Antioch flexes northeast to join the corridor of the ancient Royal Road. Stretching from Sardis in western Anatolia, the Royal Road provided the great trunk route between the Aegean and Persia, notably in the Achaemenid and Hellenistic periods. On the other hand, if the traveller's destination is Mesopotamia, landing at the port of Antioch, ancient Seleucia, and choosing the inland route via Aleppo allows easy passage across relatively flat country, by far the fastest way of reaching the next opportunity for waterborne traffic, the Euphrates. It is therefore not the immediate benefits of Aleppo's topography, but its access to two nearby key communication routes that have sustained the city's historical role. As the long-distance trade in such key commodities required by ruling groups across the Fertile Crescent grew, Aleppo's territory stood alongside a web of routes transferring precious metals, copper, and wood, especially to Mesopotamian markets deficient in these essentials. Even when at last the domestication of the camel in the early first millennium made the cross-desert route to the lower reaches of the Tigris-Euphrates viable, Aleppo still offered the greatest choice of access to long-distance trade flows. Environment. While Aleppo's environs lack perennial streams, the city lies within the 200 Isahayat rainfall zone, usually enough to ensure adequate grain supply and pasture across the flat, open countryside. The stonier limestone country to its west and north is less favourable to broad-scale agriculture, but can support grazing and the growing of olives and fruits on the slopes or in pockets of relatively rich soil trapped between rising country. The climate of inland northern Syria is relatively harsh. Long, cloudless summer months offer temperatures around 35 to 40 degrees with no rain. In winter, minimum temperatures often descend to just above freezing, occasionally diving to minus 10, and the city experiences a variable pattern of rain arriving in cloudbursts with occasional snow. The unequal distribution of rain throughout the year brings a reliance on adequate water storage. The runoff from the higher land to the north cannot be counted on for the rest of the year, and subterranean capture is limited. The variety of crops grown is therefore limited to those that can avoid or endure the long, rainless summers. More intensive zones of fertility can be found in the shallow valleys fed by streams, including the Quake, but they are often very seasonal in their flow. Even water for domestic use could be problematic. The city's fresh water was supplemented by channels bringing water from the springs at Hilan in the hills to the north. This supply was delivered by aqueduct from the Roman period. Much of the water was then stored under the city in domestic cisterns, many of which survive to this day. Besides grain, traditionally corn and wheat, fruits and nuts, Aleppo lies in country best suited to the raising of sheep and goats, usually grazing between seasonally productive agricultural areas. Aleppo largely learned about trading the hard way, through millennia of experience of buying in supplies and processing and trading products to surrounding markets, especially to the north. However, in periods of longer-term stability, Aleppo moved to a new level of prosperity. Its access to long-distance trade with regions far to the north, east, and southeast tapped markets ranging as far as Baghdad and Basra down the river system of the Tigris-Euphrates, Persia to the east, and Asia Minor to the north and west. A high place. If Aleppo had nothing much to offer to attract a permanent population of any size, what accident of history led to its steady rise to urban status and eventually to its rank as the most populous of the major cities of Syria? It had one small feature that other centres lacked: an elevated rocky outcrop on the edge of the steppe, which could readily house an important defensive or religious centre. Prominent man-made mounds, or tells, dot the countryside of northern Syria, marking population centres that died out millennia ago, leaving behind the accumulated detritus of their houses and contents. Aleppo's central mound, today occupied by the magnificent citadel of the Islamic Middle Ages, has long been a feature that defined the city's profile and provided it with a major defensive asset. Unlike the customary mound or tell left by layers of human occupation, Aleppo's citadel rise is a largely natural rock feature, though to some extent its features have been rounded off by the shaping of the material remains of many centuries. A medieval visitor from Al-Andalus, Ibn Jubir, marvelled at the claim that the rocky rise had its own natural spring that permanently assured a supply of water. But it is more likely that the early inhabitants relied on two deep caverns serving as cisterns topped up by the winter rains. If we look further at the terrain beneath the centre of the modern city, the reasons for its early rise to fame might become a little more apparent. The ground underneath the historic walled city of Aleppo has two underlying features. The first is already apparent from historic engravings. The Citadel Hill, that rises to 437 metres above sea level, and thus almost 40 metres above the level of the plain. There is, however, a second elevated feature on the western side of the historic city centre, the Aqaba Quarter, in English, the Slope. Not noticed by most visitors, this hill is lower, rising only some 20 metres above the city's average. This prominence lies on the northwestern edge of the area later defined by the ancient and medieval city grid, which would fill the area between the Citadel Hill and the Aqaba Quarter. Attention was drawn early last century to this area as the location of an early settlement. The presence of a Mamluk mosque, Mosque al-Kikan, which included reused Late Bronze Age material, presumably found on or near the site, gave the clue. The incorporation into the mosque's walls of a stone in Luwian hieroglyphic script, referring to the dedication of a temple, indicated the site was used for religious purposes from the period of Hittite domination into the Iron Age. The western mound in the Aqaba Quarter would appear to represent the remains of an early human settlement on a site near the Quake River and its floodplain, thus close to food gardens and water. This largely artificial tell on the western side of the later walled city was barely 100 metres square, a fraction of other tells of the North Syrian steppe. It marks a small population centre on the edge of a rather meagre river, typical of the period. It is the more prominent rise under the present-day citadel that might better convey the significance of the site. We have noted already the likely defensive role of such a natural feature, a place of retreat for the inhabitants of the village in times of invasion. But it may have had an even more significant second purpose, which would better account for Aleppo's later fame. Curiosity about the likely original use of the Citadel Hill began to develop in modern times, giving rise to the temptation to explore beneath its jumbled remains of many centuries. The use of the hill as a military base, as late as Ottoman and French Mandate times, ruled this out for many decades, though interest in the area had risen with the discovery during the French army's occupation of the site in the 1920s of blocks with remarkable relief panels. It was only in the 1990s that German and Syrian excavations near the highest natural part of the rise were authorised to investigate further. The excavations revealed a large temple, spanning many centuries of occupation going back to the early Bronze Age, 2500 BC, but whose surviving elements largely date from the Late Bronze Age and Iron Age. Nothing in the few indications of Aleppo's origins outlined so far account for its later rise to prominence. The temple, however, might provide important clues. To understand its significance, we have to look more generally at the context in which Aleppo was flourishing in the northern Syria region, the role of such temples on high places, and the extent to which the religious and political life of the time was dominated by cult centres. Bronze Age, circa 3600 to circa 1200 BC. Amorites, circa 2000 to 1595 BC. Our picture of northern Syria in the Bronze and Iron Ages is still developing. The Old Testament is little help to us, as Aleppo, though later associated with legends of Abraham's journey from Mesopotamia to Jerusalem, to be examined later, fails to rate a mention. The first archaeological material from Aleppo emerges only in the second half of the second millennium, with the discovery of the temple just described. Before the recent excavations on the Aleppo Citadel, no opportunities had arisen to explore what lies beneath Aleppo. First references to Aleppo are therefore documentary, and emerged in archives dating from circa 1700 to 1600 BC, discovered at the site of Alala on the Amuk Plain, 55 kilometers west of Aleppo. The texts are in the form of cuneiform tablets, written in Akkadian and date from the period of Amorite dominance in northern Syria. We still lack precise information on the origins of this previously nomadic group, but Jebel al-Bishri, in northeastern Syria, west of the Euphrates, is recorded as the land of the Amorites, Amaru, in contemporary Akkadian records. The Amorites were able to wield power over a large part of northern Syria, eastern Turkey, and northern Iraq, where they formed the first Assyrian kingdom and brought to an end the initial phase of Mari, the great center on the mid-Euphrates, whose power had extended over much of northern Syria east of the Euphrates. Their rise to dominance in northern Iraq coincided with the end of the third dynasty of Ur, the prelude to the rule of Hammurabi of Babylon, 1792 to 1750 BC. While centralized control of the Amorite lands probably did not exist, one of the centers where an Amorite dynasty held sway was at Aleppo, capital of the kingdom known as Yamhat. The Amorite dynasty based on Aleppo became the major power in northern Syria during the period 1800 to 1600 BC. Its rule extended at times to the Euphrates and as far west as Alala. Yamhad's power was checked to the south by a new kingdom based at Katna, near modern-day Homs in central Syria. The third great power in Syria at this time was the regenerated kingdom of Mari. A young son of the dynasty, who had been sent as a child to Aleppo, was brought back to Mari to restore the dynasty's claim to the throne. His name was Zimri Lim, and his 13-year rule, 1774 to 62 BC, represented a high point in Mari's history, as many of the tablets of this period, as well as remains of the dynastic palace, perhaps sacked by Hammurabi of Babylon in 1762 BC, have been uncovered by the French excavations at Mari. Hammurabi's sacking of Mari meant that Yamhat, the Amorite centre already allied with Hammurabi, was unchallenged as the dominant power in northern Syria. The archives of Alalakh have given us one of the rare documentary insights into the affairs of the time and give some indication of Aleppo's strength, seen as rivaling even the great empires of Mesopotamia. One tablet, an intelligence report sent in by an agent at Mari on the mid-Euphrates, recorded as follows. There are 10 or 15 kings who follow Hammurabi of Babylon, and 10 or 15 who follow Rimsin of Lhasa, but 20 kings follow Yaram Lim of Yamhat. going by the book. As we move into the later 2nd millennium BC, the problems of interpretation of evidence multiply as sources become more varied. Even scientific researchers have been preoccupied by the Western fascination with accounts of the area given in the Old Testament. The dominance of the Bible narrative has meant that for a long time, everything turned up in archaeology had to be fitted into the account of the region's affairs as related in the books of the prophets, and, where possible, aligned to the king lists and other records that emerged from the plundering of Mesopotamian sites since the late 19th century. In the process, a pseudo-science of biblical archaeology emerged that put little store by what was happening, for example, in the large zone between the Tigris-Euphrates basin and the Palestinian coast. Biblical archaeology has taken a considerable battering in recent decades as scientific results put more and more distance between verifiable facts and the Bible narrative. Northern Syria was the black hole at the centre of this zone, and the assumption that its culture and economy were largely determined outside was difficult to budge. The picture was partly corrected by the discoveries made during the 8 decades of French excavations at Mari on the Middle Euphrates, and by the unearthing of Ugarit, a major Bronze Age trading centre with strong ties to Egypt and to the Aegean world. Both sites, however, were on the fringe of the Black Hole and had their own links to an outside world more familiar to Western audiences. There is, however, a good deal of other corroborative evidence that the political and religious role of Aleppo in this period spread much wider than expected. In particular, the long-standing assumptions that events in northern Syria were largely determined by cultures further south or abroad have been discredited by the results of the excavations since the 1960s by the Italian researchers at Ebla, principally under Paolo Mattia. Ebla lies 55 kilometres south of Aleppo at a site known as Tel Mardich. This vast, donut-shaped mound had long evoked curiosity given its size, but only with the commencement of the Italian excavations did the real significance of the site emerge, enabling new insights into the black hole. Extensive archives of clay tablets were found in several locations in the complex of buildings in the central Citadel area, revealing a monarchical society which attained its zenith in the second half of the 3rd millennium BC, when it controlled most of northern Syria and extending into modern Lebanon. The late 3rd millennium archives, written in a combination of Sumerian and Eblaite languages, the latter the first documented Semitic language and akin to Akkadian, provided a name for the Bronze Age city, Ebla. The records revealed a rich culture, an empire intensely oriented towards international trade, notably through the export of textiles, with links spreading from Cyprus to the lower Euphrates, as well as extensions north and south. Ebla's kings had strong associations with Ugarit on the coast and with Mari. The existence of such a powerful and populous centre close to Aleppo might lead us to think that Aleppo was only a minor tributary of the Eblaite Empire. The references to Aleppo in the Ebla tablets, however, have provided an unexpected twist. While Ebla had temples of its own, dedicated to a range of gods and goddesses, Aleppo was the cult centre, whose drawing power in the region was extensive, often embracing or even supplanting Ebler, as seen in the adoption by Ebler of Aleppo's Hadad as a patron deity after 1750 BC. Aleppo's Citadel housed a pilgrimage centre whose links drew in devotees from afar, a city whose religious role probably considerably outweighed its economic significance at the time. To what purpose did the visitors flock to Aleppo? Before returning to look for the answer on the Aleppo Citadel, we need to sketch the changing historical scene in northern Syria. Hittite dominance. Halab, 1595 to circa 1200 BC. Aleppo in the early 2nd millennium BC, as noted earlier, had been the capital of the important kingdom of Yamhat. Yamhat's supremacy in the region was clipped by the rise of the Hittites, whose empire at its peak from the mid-14th through much of the 13th centuries was to dominate the affairs of the late Bronze Age Near East. It was the Hittite king, Hattusili I, who reigned circa 1650 to circa 1620 BC, who first made inroads into northern Syria from his base in central Anatolia to the northwest. These moves reflected ambitions for wider empire, and more specifically, Hattusili's aim to secure a dominant trade role, controlling the supply line for tin from Iran and Afghanistan, an essential element in bronze making. Hattusili's first objective became Aleppo, in order to benefit from Yamhad's strategic position straddling trade lines, particularly for tin and copper. Aleppo's prominent citadel had ensured that the city did not fall to the invaders, on this the first of probably a number of attempts by Hattusili. However, Aleppo's importance in the Hittite scheme of things was illustrated by the creation of a temple to Aleppo's storm god in the Hittite capital, Hattusa, following Hattusili's campaign. Eventually the city, known to the Hittites as Halab, was taken by Musili I, the successor and probably the grandson of Hattusili, in circa 1595 BC. The taking of Halab marked the end of the kingdom of Yamhat, but the beginning of a prominent role for Aleppo in the Hittite Empire, marking the beginning of the Hittites' wider designs not only on Syria, where they sought to block inroads from Egypt to the south, but also on Mesopotamia. Babylon fell in the same year, bringing to an end the old Babylonian kingdom, Babylon's first flowering in the Near Eastern world. Mitanni, Hittite Kingdom and Egypt, circa 1500 to 1274 BC. In the wider region on which the Hittites were now encroaching, the dominant power was that of Mitanni, a Hurrian-speaking confederacy in northeast Syria, probably centred on the upper Khabur River. While the Mitanni had a common interest with the Hittites in ensuring that the Egyptian New Kingdom did not take a permanent hold in northern Syria, ultimately the Mitanni represented a greater threat to Hittite ambitions in Syria than the Egyptians. This three-way contest for Syria between the Hittite Kingdom, Mitanni, and Egypt was one of the defining features of the late Bronze Age in Syria, inevitably drawing in Aleppo, which lay at the point of convergence of the three powers. The extension of Hittite dominance across northern Syria had only brought a temporary end to Halab's monarchy, which had been re-established under Mitannian sovereignty. A line of 15th century BC puppet kings was installed in Aleppo by the Mitannian king Paratana. Khalab was again recorded as a client of the kingdom of Mitanni in the 14th century BC, and attempted a new assertion of Aleppan local dominance in northern Syria under Mitannian tutelage. Aleppo then ranked possibly as a temple estate under the authority of a Mitannian viceroy at Alala. Aleppo normally succeeded in remaining beyond the reach of Egyptian ambitions to extend its influence into northern Syria in the late Bronze Age. Egyptian attempts to gain a foothold on the plain around Aleppo had begun in the 15th century by engaging Alala as its vassal, but were only temporarily successful. In the three-way pattern of rivalry between Egyptians, Hittites, and Mitanni, Aleppo usually only had to find a modus vivendi between the Hittites and the Mitanni. Though a tentative renewal of Egyptian moves into northern Syria was made by Thutmosis III, Battle of Megiddo, 1458 BC, campaigning as far as the Euphrates. Egyptian treaties with several of the states under Mitannian dominance, however, only temporarily held off a resurgence of Mitannian power. Renewed Hittite interest in the region resulted in a campaign under King Supilulyuma I, who reigned 1350 to 1322 BC, to end Mitannian supremacy in northern Syria. Khalab was chosen as the residence of a Hittite viceroy. Supilulyuma's son, Telepinu, after 1327 BC. One of only two such vice-regal seats in Syria. The continued prestige of the weather god temple on Aleppo's citadel is underlined by the appointment of Telepinu as high priest of the cult that was honoured in both Syria and Anatolia. The next Hittite-appointed king, Talmi Sharuma, is the last recorded in Bronze Age records. It is clear from the Hittite records that Talmi Sharuma was not a powerful ruler, and from the reign of Mursili II, Kirkemish was recognized as the dominant Hittite center in the region. Instructions issued to Talmi Sharuma from the Hittite capital make it clear that he was not to extend his influence regionally at the expense of Hittite imperial interests. This renewed expression of Hittite interest in Syria in the 14th century inspired Egypt to return to the Syrian game, particularly to counter the Hittite new kingdom leader, Tudhaliya, first half of the 14th century. An uneasy Hittite-Egyptian line of control across central Syria prevailed for the next century, with Mitannian influence confined further east. Among the powers contending for Syria, however, there appears to have been an expectation, certainly between the Hittites and the Egyptians, that this tacit division had to be finally decided in battle. The stage was set near the central Syrian town of Kadesh, a little southwest of modern-day Homs. By the mid-13th century, the greater Syrian ambitions of the 19th dynasty pharaohs prompted Aleppo to contribute its forces to the Hittite-sponsored confederation which countered Ramses II at the Battle of Kadesh in 1274 BC. While the battle for the Egyptians was at best a draw, or possibly a rout, it provided copious material for Ramses II's self-promotion program in Egypt, featuring five times on billboard-like battle scenes on Egyptian temples. In the longer term, though, it was certainly a bloody nose for pharaonic Egypt. attempts to sustain control so far north in the Levant had proven difficult, and New Kingdom Egypt did not seek to test its Syrian ambitions while the Hittites remained. The Storm God. While Aleppo's political role largely succumbed to the great power game being played out in Syria, its religious importance was still significant. One insight that the Old Testament has given us is the importance in Bronze and Iron Age Syria and Palestine of the worship on high places, usually mountaintops, which brought the worshipper closer to the heavens, providing a more direct link with the deity controlling rainfall and thus fecundity. At times, the Old Testament seems obsessed with the lingering influence of high places, with over 50 references to such cult centres as anathema to the followers of the monotheistic cult of Yahweh. Northern Syria in particular is dotted with elevated platforms apparently devoted to the cult of the storm god, Hadad, in most sources. In Iron Age central Syria and the coast, the god is given the title Baal, Lord, often with different local combinations such as Baal Shamin. His various manifestations amounted to one of the most widespread cults in the ancient Near East, and thus the great adversary of the Hebrew Yahweh. In centres with multiple temples, Baal Hadad is usually given first billing in the Phoenician tradition, e.g. Ugarit, and his influence prevailed inland, as at Damascus, where he would later be loosely assimilated to the Roman Jupiter. Most of the high places, at least originally, were simply adapted from natural formations, with a bench and lustral basin carved into the rock and no superimposed structures. Other sites were later given conventional temple buildings. It therefore came as no surprise that the temple unearthed in the 1990s on the Aleppo Citadel proved to be honouring the storm god, Adu, in his local designation. The first indication that an important religious complex might exist in this area had come with the discovery in 1930 of a basalt relief slab. Dated to the 9th or 8th centuries BC, two genii are depicted under a crescent moon framing a radiating sun, indicating a cult associated with the heavens. The excavations, begun in 1996 and directed by K. Kohlmeier, revealed a building of massive proportions, possibly 35 metres wide and 26 deep. While the excavators faced numerous challenges in exposing the site, one of the deepest soundings of any urban dig in Syria, from it has emerged one of the most important temple structures of the Bronze Age Middle East. The temple was in use almost continuously from the early Bronze Age to the Iron Age, about 2500 BC to the 9th century BC, surviving across numerous cultures. We have seen above the importance attached to the temple as a cult centre of regional significance for the Hittites. This reflected what was already a long tradition. The first references to the king of Ebla journeying to worship at the Aleppo temple originated circa 2500 BC. The Middle Bronze Age building comprised a large hall 20 by 17 metres, oriented west to east, with the main shrine on the middle of the north side, approached by the southern door leading in from an equally broad porch. The god's cult figure is described in documents from Mari as a huge seated figure in the round, with a smaller sun god on his knees. The major reconstruction phases of the temple in the late Bronze and Iron Ages have provided the bulk of the present remains, beginning with the shrine as reconstructed under the kings of Yamhat, when the shrine is mentioned in tablets from Mari. Transition to the Iron Age, circa 1200 to 900 BC. Within 50 years of the great battle at Kadesh, the slate of Middle Eastern affairs was virtually wiped clean. From around 1200 BC, the Levant experienced widespread disruption, the causes of which are still difficult to identify. The mysterious incursions of the Sea Peoples, first noted in Egyptian temple records in the late 13th century BC, turned the region upside down, bringing the end of the old empires, such as that of the Hittites, or even of a major trading city, such as Ugarit, and leaving few, if any, of the population groups of the late Bronze Age still intact. This disruption brought new population movements, possibly in some cases peaceful or quietly absorbed, over a number of years. Our picture of events in northern Syria in the transition from late Bronze to early Iron Age is still being assembled. Until recently, it was commonly assumed that virtually all the Bronze Age societies vanished in this series of population movements. Egyptian and Ugaritic records described the arrival of the Sea Peoples, who appeared to have had their origins in Anatolia to the north. The new excavations on the Aleppo Citadel, however, have contributed to a new perspective. The fact that there is no evidence of disruption on the Aleppo Citadel mound, and possibly at other inland centres, suggests that the Sea Peoples, probably more a series of domino effect population movements rather than a concerted wave, may be more a coastal phenomenon with limited secondary effects inland. A recent survey of the evidence of collapse sees no single cause as responsible for such widespread disruption, but rather a range of factors that occurred during the first half of the 12th century BC. A systems collapse intensified by a multiplier effect, in which one factor affected the others, which it took some decades to recover from. Aramean and Neo-Hittite states, circa 1100 to circa 900 BC. The traditional picture had also assumed that the end of a golden age of late Bronze Age trade and prosperity was linked in the inland centres to the arrival of a new population group, the Arameans. The people labelled Arameans assumed power in a series of cities of the Syrian inland by 1000 BC. Recent research, again based partly on the findings on the Aleppo Citadel, has brought a corresponding revision of traditional assumptions. The fact that the transition seems to have occurred without major destructive evidence at Aleppo in the period 1200 to 1100 BC, previously written off as a forgotten Dark Age, has upset many received views. In northern Syria, in this confused phase after 1200 BC, there seem to be two major influences at play. Trevor Bryce notes that there had already been a considerable shift of ruling elements from the Hittite realm into northern Syria in the last centuries of the late Bronze Age, evidenced in the creation of vice-regal presences at Kirkemish and Aleppo. Some Luwian-speaking elements of this shift survived and formed Neo-Hittite princely houses in the early Iron Age. At the same time, a more prominent role in the region developed around several centres identified with Aramean newcomers. Alterations to the Aleppo storm god temple, a cult whose fame had already spread, as we have seen, to the Hittite capital, perhaps reflect this pattern of change within continuity. Under Hittite domination, the Aleppo temple's orientation had been changed from its broad temple plan, common in northern Syria, with the main cult figure opposite the southern doorway, to a plan focusing attention to the east, in the Hittite tradition. In the temple's last phase, post-1100 BC, the plan was switched back to the north-south orientation, when a local dynast, King Taita, renewed the emphasis on the central niche along the north wall. This phase saw a rearrangement of carved stone panels, both new and from earlier phases, late Bronze and Iron Ages, and would appear to be evidence of a willingness to refer back to older traditions. In the final arrangements, the selections varied from the familiar theme of the storm god wielding his axe or club to weird mythical figures such as the male shrink-wrapped in the scales of a fish, a Mesopotamian theme, or human heads on the bodies of griffins or bulls. Who were the Arameans, who now became the dominant culture? People described under variations of the name Aramean had appeared in written records from as early as the mid-second millennium. Research by Herbert Near in 2014 indicates that there was a considerable increase in the number of settlements in the Iron Age compared to the Late Bronze Age, but that initially the new settlements were small, indicating a dispersal of the population into small rural settlements, lacking at first any unified political structure. This suggests there was no massive new influx into northern Syria, but a process by which small Aramean-speaking communities, previously nomadic, settled down and became the nucleus of a new leadership element as the predominant influence of the Hittites and their Luwian-speaking allies began to wane. These Arameans, speakers of a Semitic language, may have originated in northeastern Syria through the consolidation of pastoral communities, who turned to a settled way of life. However, we have no evidence that they had assumed an identity based on a common Aramean ethnos. Rather, they were an amalgam, probably peacefully achieved, of existing population groups with the addition of new elements and through the adoption of a new common language. The new states went on to become a rallying point amid the disruptions of the coming centuries, and their language would endure even to the time of Christ, when it provided a lingua franca to the wider region. While it is now clear that the population movements triggered by the sea peoples along the coast did not affect all of northern Syria directly, the widespread disruption may indirectly have stifled trade and the ability of traditional powers, notably the Hittites, the Egyptians, and the powers that be of Mesopotamia, the Kassite kingdom, to play a direct role in the area. This uncertainty in the period 1200 to 1000 BC appears to have given new opportunities for groups already partly resident in the region to assert a leadership role, without necessarily displacing the existing population groups. As Aramean rulers began to consolidate power at several centres by the early first millennium, they erected buildings that signalled societies which had assumed roles beyond that of a subsistence economy. Much of the existing material culture simply continued, in some cases, under these new rulers, who often sought to emulate their predecessors. They adapted the imagery of the previous dominant imperial presence in the area, the Hittites, and have thus been given the label of Neo-Hittite in recent decades. While some dynastic offshoots from the Hittite Luwian-speaking dynasties of earlier times survived in the area alongside the Aramean rulers, the term Neo-Hittite would be misleading if taken to imply a resurgence of centralized Hittite identity or political power. Rather, in many cases, all that was involved in a center like Aleppo was a simple merging of earlier imagery with elements from Assyria to the east, which was soon to seek a dominant role in Syria in the 9th century. To summarize, Aleppo, now reborn as an Aramean Age center, was still drawing on many of the old trappings of the Hittite era. It may have come under the principality Bit Agusi, whose capital Arpad was probably Tel Rifat, not far to the north, an Aramean kingdom. Aleppo seems to have fallen in prestige. Possibly it retained local importance as the major centre for agriculture along the river. It was the temple, however, which continued to attract patronage from local dynasts, who sponsored the renewal of much of its basalt relief panelling, but arranged the new and the old relief figures in imaginative new combinations. The 11th century ruler of Unki, King Taita, now controlled Aleppo from his base in the Amuk Plain, Kinalua. The king was displayed, presenting tribute to the storm god, Khadad, confecting a new tribute scene by repositioning an earlier relief of the god beside a new panel depicting the king. Trade. While it is difficult to be definitive about the evidence for the ethnic composition of the new entities in northern Syria, it seems clear that the region benefited greatly from several developments that greatly promoted new trade links across political borders. Two breakthroughs were particularly important. The development of techniques for the production of iron introduced agricultural tools, providing ways to cultivate soils once seen as too hard to work. Second, the domestication of the camel meant that trade could span longer distances without access to water, thus opening up faster routes across the Syrian steppe, particularly to the southeast. Aleppo must have benefited greatly from both developments. New trade routes were most easily accessed from Aleppo's commanding position, and its region found new opportunities to develop agricultural products for export. The trading energy generated by the Phoenician coastal communities also played into a burgeoning economic picture inland, and the demand for the cedar of Mount Lebanon brought a new emphasis on longer distance trade, particularly into Iran. Art. The art of the Aramean period in Aleppo is known to us now by the relief decorations used to adorn the weather god temple, complementing the other scattered finds from the region around Aleppo. The style is common to numerous Neo-Hittite sites across northern Syria and northwest into the Anatolian mountains. Depictions of gods, kings, mythical figures, and beasts are often stiff and stylized, borrowing some thematic elements, without the scale, from the massive relief panels found in contemporary Mesopotamia, but notably more human and intimate in some instances. For example, the superb relief panels from Nirab, 15 kilometers southeast of Aleppo, now in the Louvre. A more awkward attempt at the gargantuan was found early last century at the site of Tel Khalaf, ancient Gazana, well to the east of Aleppo, alongside the line of the Ottoman railway to Baghdad. These huge orthostats show mythical beasts guarding the palace of the local Aramean ruler, an attempt to terrify rather than impress. Most of the basalt pieces were taken to Berlin, where they suffered severely in a British bombing raid in 1945. Some, however, survived better in the Aleppo Museum, where reconstructed versions of the palace guardians still play their customary role, protecting the main entrance in formidable array. Neo-Assyrian dominance, 883 to 612 BC. By the 9th century BC, the two centuries of consolidation in North Syria were disturbed by another intrusion from the Mesopotamian world to the east. The rise to regional dominance of Assyria represented a revival of the ambitions of the second millennium Assyrian Empire. This time, the Neo-Assyrian push to the west sought to extend their control from their northern Iraq base, in modern terms, as far as the Mediterranean, by co-opting or absorbing the small Aramean and Neo-Hittite states. The latter were too tiny and disunited to meet the challenge on their own, but occasionally managed to form loose confederations among themselves and with the biblical states to the south. The first signs of Assyrian ambitions to incorporate the Aramean and Neo-Hittite kingdoms into the structure of Assyrian provinces occurred when the two entities east of the Euphrates, Bit Bahiani and Bit Adini, were taken into the Assyrian sphere in the first half of the 9th century BC. The Neo-Assyrian drive westwards became more aggressive under Ashurnasipal II, 883 to 859 BC, who campaigned 14 times in his attempts to expand his empire. Neo-Assyrian control was frequently challenged by the Aramean and Neo-Hittite states. In 853, a confederation led by the king of Hamath and joined by Ahab, king of Israel, met the Neo-Assyrian forces under Shalmaneser III outside the city of Karka on the Orontes. Shalmaneser had arrived via the northern route, taking Aleppo on the way, where continuing respect for the storm god required him to make offerings at his temple. At Karka, one of the reputedly great battles of the ancient world, said to involve prodigious numbers on both sides, in fact seems to have yielded uncertain results. The Assyrian king was forced to campaign for another decade to put down rebellions. Shalmaneser III's taking of Damascus in 841, for example, prompted Hazael of Damascus to recover much of central Syria, and it took another 100 years and a second battle outside Karka, 720 BC, to produce a decisive victory for Assyria. By then, Neo-Assyrian sway extended even as far as the Phoenician coast, modern Lebanon. The Phoenicians, successors of the Canaanites, had established a wide-ranging network of commercial and colonizing enterprises as far as North Africa and Spain. The Assyrians largely saw advantage in allowing a higher degree of autonomy to the Phoenicians to maximize their own commercial advantage. Much of the drive behind the Neo-Assyrian imperial project was thus commercial, with the western provinces in Syria exploited through the massive export of commodities, especially timber and slaves. The empire was never fully established on a sustainable basis, and periods of military aggression were interspersed with loss of control, particularly in areas neighbouring the Neo-Hittite or Phrygian states to the north, or the Egyptian Nubian kingdoms to the south. Neo-Babylonian and Persian rule, 612 to 333 BC. The Neo-Assyrian Empire thus easily fell prey to the ambitions of the next wave of rulers who established themselves in Iran and swept through the Neo-Assyrian domains in Mesopotamia. The Neo-Babylonian ruler Nabopolassar, reigning 626 to 605 BC, captured and sacked the Neo-Assyrian capital Nineveh in 612 BC. His son, Nebuchadnezzar, was appointed to lead a campaign that took Carchemish in 605 BC in order to fend off an Egyptian attempt under the pharaoh Necho to move back into Syria. The Neo-Babylonians ruled in alliance with the Medes, a group who had moved their power base from the Zagros Mountains of Iran to the southwest. The Neo-Babylonian Empire increasingly succumbed to the ambitions of the Median-Persian side of the alliance, who in 559 BC struck westwards to realize their earlier ambitions to establish a state of their own under the Achaemenid dynast Cyrus II, the Great. Cyrus had virtually unlimited ambitions, extending Persian control from Central Asia and as far west as the Mediterranean. The next generation of Achaemenid rulers pushed as far as Cyprus, Egypt, and into the western reaches of Asia Minor, pressing against the Greek-speaking states around the Aegean. In 538, Syria became one of the satrapies of the empire under a system that gave considerable autonomy to local communities, and under which the retention of Aramaic as the everyday language of communication was encouraged. Persian ambitions peaked under Darius I, 522 to 486 BC, who campaigned on the Greek mainland while controlling for a time regions as far east as Sindh in modern Pakistan. We have no reminders of these troubled centuries under the Neo-Assyrians, the Neo-Babylonians, or the Achaemenid Persians in the rare pre-classical finds that have emerged from Aleppo or its environs. Generally, these empires left little for the benefit of the Syrian population, preferring to take Syria's wealth, manpower, and skills to adorn their homeland, including, under Darius, the new ceremonial capital at Persepolis. A few hints of Achaemenid influence, however, are found 200 kilometers to the southwest of Aleppo on the Syrian coast, near Tartus. Here, the site of Amrit, lying opposite the Phoenician settlement on the island of Arwad, gives a few indications of the blending of Achaemenid and Phoenician influences in the architecture of the temple of Melkart and a small group of funerary towers. Aleppo, however, was barely a way station at this time. The Persian satrap, governor of the region, was stationed not at Aleppo but at a nearby town, Al-Bab, now a dusty way station on the route to the Euphrates and the Jazeera. Aleppo was not noted in any of the written records of the Iron Age. It still enjoyed a certain religious fame through the weather god temple. On the Citadel Hill, the memory of the palaces of the Hittites' client kings and the Aramean princes perhaps lingered. But the village itself was barely distinguished from a number of other small inhabited centres clinging to the narrow, fertile band along the Quaig. Alexander, 333 to 323 BC. Since the 5th century, the Persian Empire of the Achaemenids had long taunted the Greek states by seeking dominance in the Aegean. Alexander, the young son of Philip II of the northern Greek kingdom of Macedonia, grew up amid vivid tales of the 5th century battles which had turned back aggressive Persian campaigns at Thermopylae, Marathon, and Salamis. Driven, according to classical sources, by a mission to liberate the Greeks of Asia Minor from Persian rule, Alexander's army crossed the Hellespont to the Asian shore in 333 BC. As he pursued his campaign against Persia, the revenge motive assumed wider dimensions that were to culminate in widespread carnage and the burning of the Achaemenid ceremonial capital at Persepolis in 330 BC. Settling the score after the 5th century sacking of Athens by the Persian army. As Alexander pursued his campaign to the east, the first major battle against the Persian forces under Darius III was in 333 BC at Issus, not far from Aleppo, but on the Mediterranean side of the coastal range, just near the later Greek-founded city Alexandretta, today Iskanderun. Darius suffered a disastrous defeat, but escaped east towards his homeland. Alexander decided not to set off in pursuit, but took the Persians' disarray as an opportunity to divert south down the coast. His first objective was to seize the Phoenician cities so important in the region's trade flows, and to capture their fleet. His second was to press on into Egypt, there to explore his possible deification by consulting the oracle at the Temple of Amun in the oasis of Siwa in the western desert. Alexander's 10-year campaign then resumed its path towards Iran. The fortuitous death of Darius, who had fled as far as northeast Iran in an attempt to rally forces to his failing cause, meant the Achaemenid Empire, after two further decisive losses, passed to the Greeks. Alexander's efforts to pacify and reorganize this huge domain was cut short by his death in Babylon in 323 BC. The first challenge facing his followers was to settle Alexander's inheritance among his generals. The span of the new empire from Greece to India was too much for one ruler to control, and a series of conflicts over succession saw the territory divided by 301 BC between three dominant figures drawn largely from his generals: Antigonus in Syria and Mesopotamia, Ptolemy in Egypt, and Cassander and Lysimachus, dividing western Asia Minor and Greece. Lesser princes, or satraps, ruled in the constellation of small principalities distributed as far as modern Karachi in Pakistan. Many areas along the seams between these kingdoms, however, were contested. Syria, in particular, was uneasily partitioned between Ptolemy and Antigonus. The vague line of control initially ran across modern southern Syria, but wavered during wars of succession that marked the 3rd century BC. Aleppo, however, remained securely on the Seleucid side. Antigonus died in battle in 301 BC, Ipsus, and the western parts of his kingdom, Anatolia and Syria, fell to Seleucus I Nicator, who, as satrap in Babylon, had already conducted a fierce and prolonged campaign to prevent Antigonus from usurping his command. Seleucus now joined Syria to his former domain, which had nominally covered Babylonia, all of Iran, and the empire to the east. Seleucus was a determined leader who appreciated that, after the constant wars between Alexander's generals, he needed to provide the enormous spread of his realm with a viable structure through a clear chain of command and an impregnable base. Seleucus decided to fashion such a structure around two capitals, Antioch in northern Syria and his old command Babylon, later moved to nearby Seleucia on the Tigris in Mesopotamia. The arrival of the Greeks in Syria brought an end to centuries of control of northern Syria from Mesopotamia or Iran, and gave the region a new orientation towards the Mediterranean and with a focus on Hellenic civilization. This was to influence Syria's choices for the next 1,000 years. Chapter 2. Greek and Roman Aleppo. Hellenistic period, 300 to 31 BC. Roman period, 31 BC to 353 AD. So far we have had few clues as to how Aleppo housed its inhabitants. The only hints to its layout we have discerned have been the Citadel Hill to the east and the smaller rise now covered by the intramural quarter of Al-Aqaba at the western end of the cross-city axial route. While the citadel was a largely natural feature, providing a prominent position both for a palace for the local sovereign and for a religious centre devoted to the storm god, the lower rise to the west was primarily the place where the population lived, close to the Koyk River and its gardens. That picture did not fundamentally change during the centuries of rule by Aramean, Neo-Assyrian, Neo-Babylonian, and Achaemenid Persian rulers. It seems likely that, although Aleppo at times was still ruled by local princes serving as clients to kings elsewhere, its wider regional role was defined by its residual religious influence, resulting from the fame of its now 2,000-year-old cult centre, still one of the preeminent high places in a region studded with such shrines. The Greeks, too, have left us with no evidence of their settlement of Aleppo beyond that perennial device for a managerial makeover, a name change. The city had long been known, as it is today in Arabic, by a variant of the name first recorded in the early 2nd millennium BC, Khalab. The Seleucids established one of their kingdom's capitals less than 100 kilometres away at Antioch in order to stamp a Greek imprint on the area. It had become the habit of the Hellenistic kingdoms to choose place names referring to their Macedonian origins, honouring the origins of the Diadochi, Alexander's generals, or other regime figures and their wives, mothers, or sisters. This applied both to the many new foundations, meant to implant a Hellenized identity in an area through Greek language, education, and political institutions, and to existing towns, which were simply rebadged. Aleppo was in the last category. Thus, Khalab became Beroia, a reference to the Macedonian city Varoia, second most important of the cities of the Macedonian kingdom after Pella, but today a minor town often rendered as Veria in English, 75 kilometres southwest of Thessaloniki in northern Greece. Seleucus I Nicator was reported in later classical sources as the founder of Beroia. Born to an aristocratic Macedonian family, Seleucus had been steeped in the atmosphere of Hellenism as a boy, when he shared the young Alexander's lessons under Aristotle. He served loyally in Alexander's expedition to the East, and his flexibility of spirit persuaded him not only to join in the mass marriage ceremony arranged by Alexander at Susa, but also to remain with his chosen bride, an Iranian princess, Apama, who was to produce his heir, Antiochus I. Seleucus' policy of enlightened Hellenism recognized the need for an amalgam of Greek and Persian traditions. This, however, did not rule out the conferral of dynastic names on most of the major towns of Syria. These towns were given implantations of colonies of Greek settlers, though often the Greek element was housed in separate quarters established alongside the existing Iron Age centres. Even smaller centres and many rural areas received Greek colonies, often retirement schemes for members of the army at the end of their careers, but with the dual purpose of planting Greek control through the institution of the city, polis, regarded by the Greeks as the essential framework underpinning civilized values. If we look at a map of northern Syria under the Greeks, the pattern of the contribution the network of cities made to the maintenance of a Greek identity is clear. It is a remarkable tribute to the Greeks' capacity to identify locations essential in implanting a Greek identity on the region, that virtually all of the first-rank centres chosen as Greek urban centres remain major cities to this day. In northern Syria, only a few of the second-rank towns were deserted in the post-classical period, such as Cyrus and Chalcis, Kunasrin. Moreover, the word polis, plural poleis, applied to the new and adopted cities, was more than just recognition of a city's precedence as an urban centre. It denoted, too, that it possessed the institutions that the Greeks found essential to their way of life. An assembly of elected citizens, or boula, occasional gatherings of the demos, defined as those people educated in the Greek language and to a syllabus that reflected Hellenized values. Classical notions of Athenian democracy might have fitted awkwardly with Seleucus' ideas of an overarching monarchic structure, but it did leave the administration of cities largely in local hands, a practice that was to survive well into Roman times. This guided democracy became a way of unleashing the energies of a community and brought a sense of healthy competition between urban centres. It is difficult to discern how local non-Greek inhabitants of a city might access these institutions. Perhaps at least one generation was required to gain the familiarity with Greek as a language to enable Syrians to gain admission, if at all. As the centuries passed, though, the degree of convergence between Syrian local identity and the advantages of a common system based on Hellenized values seems to have been broadly accepted. Seleucus Tetrapolis. By far the most important of the new cities in Syria was Antioch, a new foundation on virgin ground. Within 3 centuries, it rose from nothing to become one of the great metropoles of the classical world, the third city of the world, in Josephus' euphoric description, in the late 1st century AD. Its rise was not quite as spectacular as that of the Ptolemaic capital at the mouth of the Nile, Alexandria, which could draw on a court society endowed on an extravagant scale by Egypt's annually renewed fecundity and by the memories.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.